गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे वी आर गोना स्टार्ट द नेक्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ द चैप्टर द समर ऑफ ब्यूटीफुल व्हाइट हॉर्स. वी हैव ऑलरेडी कंप्लीटेड अ पार्ट ऑफ इट वेयर वी आर अक्वेंटेड विद द थ्री कैरेक्टर्स दैट वी हैव कम अक्रॉस. फर्स्ट इट्स एरम हु इज द नरेटर ऑफ द स्टोरी. ही इज 9 ईयर्स ओल्ड एंड देन द मुराद. मुराद इज द कजिन ऑफ एरम एंड ही इज द वन हु स्टील्स द हॉर्स. बोथ ऑफ देम स्टील द हॉर्स बिकॉज दे वांट टू राइड इट. तो एरम नोज दैट ही हैव स्टोलन द हॉर्स एंड इट्स अ काइंड ऑफ अ शेम फॉर देम बिकॉज दे बिलोंग टू द गार्गोलेनियन ट्राइब. दिस tribe had hold this centuries long tradition of being extremely honest, and they are extremely honest for 1100 centuries. They can adopt any mean other than being dishonest and all, but Murad is the person who steals this horse. Though Aram gives an excuse that he doesn't want to steal the horse for, having any money or selling the horse into the market, but they just want to enjoy riding it because it had been their lifelong dream of owning a horse, and which is practically impossible for them to do because they belong to an extremely poor tribe and their family cannot afford to cater to all such luxuries. And then we are being informed by Aram that Murad is a crazy trick of the family and he can do whatever he wants. He lives life to his fullest. He seems like he have dropped into this earth and he wants to enjoy the world throughout, not stopping for a moment at all. And he seemed to be the crazy the crazy descendant of this another crazy person who is known throughout this Gargolinian tribe for being crazy and extremely irritable. It's Uncle Khushrobe. He is a man with a very whimsical temper and he is an enormous man. We are given a proper character and physical appearance sketch of this man, and we can understand that this man is extremely irritated in nature and he gets irritated very easily. When his house caught on fire, he didn't pay any heed to it. When some son came running informing him about the incident, he drove him up. This person lives in his own bubble and he lives in his own thoughts. He is always thinking about something is going on in his mind and he doesn't care at all about the world around him. And Aram says that Murad seems to be natural descendant of this person, though he is not a biological son of Uncle Khushrobe, but somehow he bears his uncanny resemblance with Uncle Khushrobe when his attitude comes in concern. So we will move on to the next part of the story very quickly. So we'll start from here, the second part. Not until this morning, he said. Are you telling the truth? I said. Of course not, he said. But if you have found out, that's what you are to say. So let's have a quick recap about this. So, these two boys had already enjoyed riding it. And when Murad said that I want to ride this horse alone, Aram, tried to come in terms with that. Okay, he will let him ride alone if Murad allows Aram to ride alone. And then after a successful run of Murad, when Aram was handed over the horse, he could not manage it somehow, and he fell down when the horse started running here and there. And then Murad got caught off. Murad caught this horse from around this corner and he brings him back. And then something picks into the mind of Aram. He understands that Murad have been holding into this horse for a very long time, though he was pretending that he is just having this horse since the morning there to that Aram sees the horse. But Aram can understand very well that Murad have been holding into this horse for a very long time right now, and he have somehow maintain this animal, or you have learned to maintain this animal, communicate with this animal in a proper way so that the animal understands him and he takes this animal takes its command. So this is something that Aram can pick up very easily, and he asked the question to Murad. Firstly, he didn't answer properly. Then he said that of course not, he have not got this horse earlier. And somehow he confessed this thing to Aram that yes, he had got this horse earlier, but Aram is to say to everyone that they have got this horse today morning, because otherwise he gives an excuse to Aram that otherwise people will think they are liars and this will be a shame to the 1100 years tradition of their family of being extremely honest. All right, I said. He walked the horse quietly to the barn of a deserted vineyard which at one time had been the pride of a farmer named Fethwajan. There are some oats and dry alfalfa in the barn. So this boy started what? This boy started hiding this horse because it was already daytime, and if they take this horse back, they are going to be, you know, they are going to be noticed by some people of their family as well, and this is going to create a big ruckus. That is why these two boys thought of not returning the horse, but they are going to keep it hiding at a place. So they took it to a vineyard which is now deserted and belonged to a farmer named Faith Vajan. And this vineyard contains some oats and alfalfa grass. Now alfalfa grass is a kind of grass, you will can Google it out. It's the horses love to eat this alfalfa grass. So these are all there, so they had arranged for the food of the animal too. And now they started going towards their home. "We began walking home. It wasn't easy," he said, "to get the horse to behave so nicely. At first it wanted to run wild. But as I've told you, I have a way with the horse. I can get it to want to do anything I want it to do. Horses understand me." So as usual, Murad starts telling about him. He started beating his own drum by saying that yes, it was very difficult for him at the beginning to manage this horse, but somehow he have learned to do so, and now he can make it do anything he wants it to do because he have got some sort of understanding with horses, some sort of understanding with animals. He can manage these animals very well, he can communicate them with very well. "How do you do it?" I said. "I have an understanding with the horse," he said. "Yes, but what sort of an understanding?" I said. "A simple and honest one," he said. "Well," I said, "I wish I know how to reach an understanding like that with a horse." "You are still a small boy," he said. "When you get to be 13, you will know how to do it." So Aram is little boy. He is curious about how Murad can easily maintain this horse, easily can communicate with this horse, and he keeps on asking questions. And then Murad comes up with an answer that, "Oh, you're only 9 years old. When you'll be 13 like my age?" So from very here we can understand that Murad is a 13-year-old boy. Okay, so here, as Murad says that when you will be of my age, when you'll be 13 years age, you will understand how to how to maintain a horse, how to communicate with it, how to manage it, how to give it a proper command. "I went home and ate a hearty breakfast. That afternoon, my uncle Khushrove came to our house for coffee and cigarettes. He sat in the parlor, sipping and smoking and remembering the old country." So Aram went home and then he had a hearty breakfast that his mother served for him. And over there during the afternoon, Uncle Khushrove was there visiting their house. He sat in the parlor. Now this parlor doesn't mean the beauty parlor. Parlor is a place near the kitchen counter where people sit and enjoy the small talks. And you know, Uncle Khushrove was there. He was sipping on his coffee and smoking cigarette, and he was remembering his old country. Now these people, this Kargolinian tribe, right now they're living in America, in somewhere near California, where William Sarwan himself grew up. And these places like this Walnut Avenue and the Sonjukan Valley, you will come to know about it. These are the places where William Sarwan had lived himself as a young boy, and he was an Armenian too. So this Armenian people, they were being outcasted from their country and they were forced to live in this area. And hence Uncle Khushrove, that they were sitting over there remembering his own country, and he was not in a very good mood at that day. Then another visitor arrived, a farmer named John Byro. So this is another character that we come across. Another visitor arrives over there at Aram's house, and his name is John Byro. John Byro is an Assyrian who, out of loneliness, had learned to speak Armenian. So this is, he is not an Armenian fellow, but he is only one of them, and so he has somehow, grew a rapport with this Armenian tribe, and they are his friends. So to talk with them, he have learned Armenian. "My mother brought the lonely visitor coffee and tobacco, and he rolled a cigarette and sipped and smoked. And then at last, sighing sadly, he said, 'My white horse, which was stolen last month, is still gone. I cannot understand it.'" So this John Byro is extremely important character in the story. though he moves on at the end of the story, but you can understand that he is the actual owner of the horse that Murad have taken away. And Aram was right. It is thought that yes, Murad have got hold of this horse very long time ago, and it is true, as we can hear the conversation of John Barrow and this Aram's family, that John Barrow have lost his horse. He had lost his horse at least 1 month earlier, and he is at awe that why he could not understand how this horse got stolen from him. My uncle Khushrobe became very irritated and shouted, "It's no harm. What is the loss of a horse? Haven't you all lost the homeland?" So as this uncle Khushrobe, he always wants to live in his own bubble, was irritated by these words of uncle John Barrow. He said, "People over here are losing their homeland and you're crying for your horse. This is so bad. What is this crying over a horse? That may be all right for you, a city dweller, to say," John Barrow said, "but what of my surrey? What good is a surrey without a horse?" Now John Barrow protested by saying that it is okay for you as a city dweller to say all these kind of things, because you had proper means of transport right here. But look at me, I live in the surrey. Surrey is the village area or the countryside. Okay, so I live in this village area and I need to commute from one place to another by the means of this animal only. That is why I am crying. Otherwise, there is no other option for me to commute from one place to another except this horse. Pay no attention to it, my uncle Khushrobe wrote. I walked 10 miles to get here, John Barrow said. So, as Uncle Khushrobe is one of a kind, and he said that please pay no attention to it. But John Barrow again protested by saying, why am I not going to pay attention? It is actually, you know, causing me trouble, because I have to walk 10 miles from my place till here. This is not a matter of joke, and it is impossible for me to do so every time without my horse, because there are no other means of communication and transport. You have legs, my uncle Khushrobe shouted. Now you can understand how a man this uncle Khushrobe is. Is it, you have legs, why are you crying? If you have lost your horse, doesn't matter, you still have your legs. My legs pains me, the farmer said. Pay no attention to it. Now definitely, if someone walks such a long distance, it is going to pain in their leg. And when John Barrow said, but I have to walk this 10 miles from here, and this actually caused a lot of hurt in my legs. After that, Uncle Khushrobe even said that pay no attention to it. The horse cost me $60. You know, John Barrow was adamant at his place and he's not giving up so easily. And he says, okay, first of all, I don't have a proper means of transport. My legs hurt. And now what you'll say? I paid $60 for that horse, the farmer said. And Uncle Khushrobe, being as he is, he said, I spit on money. My uncle Khushrobe said. He got up and stalked out of the house, slamming the screen door. My mother explained, he has a gentle heart, she said. It is simply that he is homesick and such a large man. Now, definitely, Aram's mother is being caught in such a, you know, caught in between such a tremendous act. And she tries to, you know, mellow it down by saying that, yes, Uncle Khushrobe, he's such an enormous man. Though he is very gentle at heart, but right now he's homesick. He's feeling bad for leaving his motherland and all, and he's upset. That is why he behaved like this, and he asked John Barrow not to mind. The farmer went away, and I ran over to my cousin Murad's house. He was sitting under a peach tree trying to repair the heart wing of a young robin, which could not fly. He was talking to the bird. "What is it?" he said. "The farmer John Barrow," I said, "he visited our house. He wants his horse. You have had it a month. I want you to promise not to take it back until I learn to ride." So Aram had heard all this conversation, and then after Uncle Khushrobe and John Barrow left, he ran over to Murad's house. Murad over there, he was sitting under a peach tree trying to repair the heart wing of a young robin. Okay, this robin is a kind of bird. And he was trying to repair the heart wing of a robin. Now from these things we can understand, from being able to manage the horse so easily, and this, you know, showing this kindness towards this bird, we can understand that definitely Murad, though he's considered crazy by his family members, but he have actually got some, you know, connection with the animals. He can know how to cure these animals. He can know how to communicate with these animals, and that is, he have got a soft corner for animals in his heart. And then over there, Aram came come and you know faces you know confronts Murad by saying that I know John Byro had came at my house and he said that you had taken his horse. I mean, he said that his horse is missing. He had having this. He was having this, white horse that is missing for 1 month. So we have already hold it for 1 month right now. Please don't return it till I learn how to ride the horse properly. It will take you a year to learn to ride, my cousin Murad said. We could keep the horse a year, I said. My cousin Murad leaped to his feet. What? He wrote. Are you inviting a member of the Gargolinian family to steal? So you can see over here when Murad says that yes, it will take you a year for it will take a year for you to learn to ride this horse. And then at that moment, Aram said, okay, then we can hold the horse for 1 year. And then somehow, you know, this Gargolinian feeling in Murad evokes up. And he says that, are you trying to prove that a Gargolinian is a thief and he's going to hold it back to someone's, holding back someone's property for such a long time? Because for him, that would be something like theft. The horse must go back to its true owner. When? I said, in 6 months at the latest, he said. So you can understand that definitely Murad is a crazy person too. He says that if he hold it for 1 month, then it is going to be theft on his part. But he can hold it for 6 months at least. And within 6 months, Aram have to learn to ride the horse and then they need to return it back to John Byro. He threw the bird into the air. The bird tried hard, almost fell twice, but at last flew high. So he had already cured this robin's wing and then it flew away. Early morning for 2 weeks, my cousin Murad and I took the horse out of the barn of the deserted vineyard where we were hiding it and rode it. And every morning the horse, when it was my turn to ride alone, leaped over grapevines and small trees and threw me and ran away. Nevertheless, I hoped in time to learn the way my cousin Murad rode. So, you know, as promised by Murad, Aram and Murad, both of them, every morning took this horse from that deserted vineyard, and then they would practice learning how to ride it, and they would practice to ride it, and every time Aram would ride alone on the horse, it would leap above upon these grapevines and other typical areas, and it used to throw Aram out of his back. But Aram also was adamant to learn riding like his cousin Murad one day. One morning on the way to Fedvajan's deserted vineyard, we ran into the farmer John Byro, who was on his way to town. Let me do the talking, my cousin Murad said. Now one day they were taking this horse back to its place in the deserted vineyard when suddenly they came across John Byro. Now definitely the owner of the horse can see the horse that is missing from him for quite a few months right now, and he is looking for that horse, and when he came across the horse, the boy seems to fall in trouble. That is why Murad comes first, you know, in support of Aram, and he says that don't worry, I'll manage it. Let me do the talking, my cousin Murad said. I have a way with farmers. Good morning, John Byro, my cousin Murad said to the farmer. The farmer studied the horse eagerly. Good morning, son of my friends, he said. What is the name of your horse? My heart, my cousin Murad said in Armenian. A lovely name, John Byro said, for a lovely horse. I could swear it is the horse that was stolen from me many weeks ago. May I look into his mouth? Of course, Murad said. So, John Byro said that you have got a lovely horse, what is its name? And Murad said that its name is My Heart in Armenian. And John Byro praised the horse by saying that it looks so beautiful and this horse bears such a resemblance with, you know, his horse that was stolen from him quite a few months ago. And he says that anyone can mistake this horse as John Byro's horse. And he also offered, you asked permission of Murad that whether he can look into the mouth of this horse. And to which Murad agreed. Tooth for tooth, the farmer looked into the mouth of the horse. Tooth for tooth, he said, I could swear it is my horse if I didn't know your parents.
The fame of your family for honesty is well known to me, yet the horse is the twin of my horse. So this is something that John Barrow answers after looking the horse. Do this horse look exactly the same of the one that he is missing right now? But he said that I know your family, I know how honest your family is, and if I had not known your family, then I would have readily suspected you as being guilty of stealing my horse from me. A suspicious man would believe his eyes instead of his heart. Good day, my young friends. Good day, John Barrow, my cousin Murad said. So he left by saying that yes, anyone can suspect after looking at this horse that it is my horse, but I know your family and I know from my heart that you people are extremely honest. And then he bid them goodbye and he left. Early the following morning, we took the horse to John Barrow's fine yard and put it in the barn. The dogs followed us around without making a sound. The dogs, I whispered to my cousin Murad. I thought they would bark. They would at somebody else, he said. I have a way with dogs. My cousin Murad put his arms around the horse, pressed his nose to the horse's nose, patted it, and then we went away. So the next morning, the two boys made up their mind and they took the horse to John Barrow's farm and they left there. While they were going over there, they were being followed, the dogs. Now, it is a tendency of dogs that if some other people come into their vicinity, they will dearly bark to them. But these dogs did not do such a thing and they actually were happy to see Murad. When Aram asked that why didn't this dogs bark at Murad, and then Murad said that don't worry, I have a thing with dogs too. I know how to manage the dogs as well. So that is why they didn't bark at me. And here we also understand that Aram and Murad had, established a friendship with this animal, this horse. And when they left it at John Barrow's farm, Murad just put his arm around the horse and, touched his nose with his nose and then patted the horse and then they left. Then they left for their home. That afternoon, John Barrow came to our house in his sari and showed my mother the horse that had been stolen and returned. I do not know what to think, he said. The horse is stronger than ever, better tempered too. I thank God. So the next afternoon, Uncle, John Barrow came into Aram's house and he showed Aram's mother the horse that was missing, and he also praised that something had happened to him. His horse has suddenly become so good and good tempered, and it's even stronger now. And I don't know how, he said. My uncle Khushrobi was in the parlor. He became irritated and shouted, quiet man, quiet, your horse has been returned. Pay no attention to it. So the story ends with this comical relief given by the uncle Khushrobi. He was sitting at that time in the parlor when John Barrow came in and showed Aram's mother the horse. He said, quiet man, quiet, you are disturbing me while I'm in my own thoughts. Please don't shout about your horse right now because you have got it back, and hence pay no attention to it. So our story ends right over here. I have already completed this entire chapter through the video. You please go through it, and tomorrow we are going to have this question and answers of this chapter. So till then, goodbye.